Hey guys, welcome to my legal classes. Today I am going to cover one of the important topic from Muslim law, that is Waqf. Not wasting your time directly getting into business, let's understand what is Waqf and what are the major terms when it comes to Waqf under Muslim law that we need to understand for the purpose of exam and to understand Muslim law very clearly. Going to the first slide, before that I have a guest here.
Hey guys, subscribe my father's channel.
He's always in hurry. Please subscribe my channel for more videos, like and share my videos. Now, you need not to worry too much on this session because I am going to give complete notes of the entire topic. There is a hell lot of case that I have brought in this session to ensure that you got sufficient materials for your exams. With that preamble, I am getting into the first slide, Waqf. In this slide, I have tried brought meaning of the term Waqf and what do we call to the person who is giving donation to Waqf, and the third one, what do we call to those managers who manage Waqf. Now, first the meaning. When I'm saying the meaning, please note that there are three major part in the definition of Waqf, that is dedication of property. So there is dedication of property done by someone, and whom are they dedicating? To the ownership of God. So somebody is dedicating their property to the ownership of God. And for what? For religious or charitable purpose is called Waqf. Dedication of property to the ownership of God for religious or charitable purpose is called Waqf. I am repeating one last time so that you remember forever. If somebody is dedicating their property to the ownership of God and if the purpose behind that is religious or charitable, then such dedication or donation is called Waqf. Now, can we use those dedicated property for the religious and charitable purpose of any religion? No. Such donations or dedications can be utilized for the benefit of Muhammadans only, which is being held in the case of Karnataka Board of Waqf versus Muhammad Nazir Ahmad. Please remember this case because at least three places I am referring these cases. This is one of the landmark cases when it comes to Waqf. So Karnataka Board of Waqf versus Muhammad Nazir Ahmad case, it was being held that the Waqf can be utilized only for the benefit of Muhammadans. And among Muhammadans, for what we can use? For the religious and charitable purpose only. Now, who is Waqif? The one who donates is called Waqif. The one who creates Waqf or one who donates the property for the purpose of Waqf is called as Waqif. And the one who manages the Waqf property is called Mutawali or manager of Waqf property. So the Waqif can appoint a person to manage the property. That person becomes Mutawali, or Waqif himself can manage the property and then he will be considered as Mutawali. Now, if in case Waqif manages the property himself, when he becomes Mutawali, he will not have any authority on the property. He will not have any property ownership on the property. He will work as a manager. He can get the salary. That's all. His power on the property is already transferred to Waqf, and he can never retain that power, which I am explaining when I am explaining the essentials of a valid Waqf. Hope it's very clear. We understood the meaning. When a person dedicates his property to the ownership of God for the purpose of religious or charitable purpose is called Waqf, and the person who is donating is called Waqif. Waqif can appoint a manager who is called Mutawali. Waqif, he himself can manage the property and then earn the salary for the role of manager, but he will not be the owner of the property. Hope that's clear. With that, I am moving to the slide number 2. Now, what are the competencies of Waqif? If someone want to donate his property for the purpose of Waqf, what are his required competency? The first one is soundness of mind. The person who is donating should have a sound mind. He should not be an idiot or a lunatic. He should be having a soundful mind. That's the first and primary requirement. And he should attain the age of majority, that is as per Indian Majority Act section number 3, which says 18 years is the age of majority. So to create a Waqf, one should attain the age of majority, that is 18 years. Now, the subject matter should be very clear. When I say subject matter, it is the ownership of property. If he is donating something for the purpose of religious or religious benefit, did I miss another term? Yeah, charitable benefit. He should have the ownership of the property. That is very important. One cannot transfer the property of others. He should have the ownership, complete ownership of the property. Then only he can create a waqf. That's the one more primary competency required. Now the fourth one, made with a clean hand. There should not be any fraudulent intent involved in it. He should make such waqf without any fraudulent mind. That is very important. The fifth one, widow can't create waqf from the property that she has as a part of unpaid dower. Now, in the case of Hari Prasad versus Fazal Ali, it was decided that a widow Muslim cannot create a waqf from the property which she is having as a part of dower. Why? Because dower is a legal right a Muslim female is having, and when husband dies, her dower should be paid by the legal heirs. Now, when they cannot pay, she can possess the property of the her ex-husband who is already expired. Now, if the legal heirs pay that dower part, then they will get the ownership on the property. So, she having the property is not independent. It is contingent to something. If they are paying the dower amount, then she has to hand over the property to them. So, it is the subject matter is not of her 100%. With that consideration, it was held in Hari Prasad versus Fazal Ali case that widow can't create waqf if the property is with her because of the dower. So that's very clear. The last one, the one who creates waqf should be a Muslim. But can non-Muslims create waqf? There are cases, there are states which have already held that can be. I'll just read through those. The dedicator must profess Islam. Okay, in case the dedicator is not Muslim, belongs to Islam religion, then he should profess Islam, that is believe in the principle of Islam's. Okay, he need not to be Muslim by religion, but he need to respect or believe the major principles of Islam. That is a requirement. And then the Madras and Nagpur high courts have held that a non-Muslim can also create a valid waqf, provided the object of waqf is not against the principle of Islam. You need to remember that the key terms that are being repeatedly used is the principle of Islam. Okay, if he is a non-Muslim, then they should respect the principle of Islam, and then they can create a waqf, and they should not do anything against the principle of Islam. Now, Patna High Court has held that a valid waqf may be constituted by a non-Muslim. However, according to Patna High Court, a non-Muslim waqf may constitute only a public waqf. A non-Muslim cannot create a private waqf. Now you are getting a new term. What is this public waqf and private waqf? They are saying it's very clear. A non-Muslim cannot create a private waqf. He can create only public waqf, whereas a Muslim can create public waqf as well as private waqf. When I am saying these two terms, I just thought I'll clarify what are this public or private waqf. Let's move on. It's very easy. Private waqf are the waqf for the benefit of his family, descendant, relatives or servants. If somebody is donating the property for the purpose of those people who belong to him, then that is called private waqf. Public waqf for the benefit of any Muslim, for the rich or the poor, for the poor only, or for the rich in the beginning and then to the poor, whatsoever. Okay, he is not mentioning to whom it goes. It is going to Muslim, but among Muslim it can be anyone. But in the private waqf, it is going to his family or descendant or other relatives or his servants. So hope that's very clear. I will not spend too much of time on that. That's type of waqf. Moving on, who can create waqf? Now there are three types one can create waqf. One is by an act of living person, that is inter vivos. If you have already studied the Property Act, I am sure you must be knowing the concept of interviewers, that is a transfer happens between two living person is called interviewers. When a person declares or dedicates his property for waqf, this can also be done while the person is on deathbed. If he is doing that in deathbed, that is called marjul maut, in which case he cannot dedicate more than 1/3 of his property for waqf without the permission from legal heirs. One cannot create more than 1/3 of his property for the purpose of waqf. Why? One of the important aspects that you need to remember is, whenever it comes to Muslim property, the major requirement for any Muslim male is to remember that he has to keep one portion of property for the purpose of dower, because dower is one of the legal right of Muslim married female. She can claim dower during marriage or after marriage or after death of her husband or divorce. You have different type of dowers, like prom dower, proper dower. There are different types of dowers available. So for the purpose of dower, one should have the property, and he should also give the property to his heirs, so that the maximum that one can create waqf is 1/3 of his property. But if his legal heirs, everybody agrees for the complete transfer to the waqf property, then he can transfer 100% to waqf. The second one is by will, waqif will, wasiyat. When a person leaves a will in which he dedicates his property after his death, earlier it was thought that Shia cannot create waqf by will, but now it has been approved. Okay, but I'll come to the other terms. If there are some other clauses which will be handled in the essential sheet, I'll clear them in the next slide. But for now, remember that one can transfer waqf by the form of will. Third one is by usage. When a property has been in use for the charitable or religious purpose for time immemorial, it is deemed to belong to waqf. No declaration is necessary and waqf is inferred. Now, nobody remembers from when they are using such property for the charitable or religious purpose. That is, there is no timeline that nobody remembers from when. In such case, by usage itself, such property becomes waqf property. Hope that's very clear. With that, I am moving to the very, very important slide, that is essential of valid waqf. This slide is the heart of this entire session. So focus, understand the concepts, remember the case clause, hope now you can take the entire screenshot. Now let's understand the subject matter, the essential of valid waqf. The first one is subject matter, that is ownership of property is very, very, very important aspect when it comes to valid waqf. One cannot create waqf from the other's property. If you have a property, if you want to dedicate your property in the name of God, if you want to dedicate your property to God, to the ownership of God for religious or charitable purpose, you can do that. But you cannot do that with somebody else's property. That is not possible. So subject matter is very, very important, and this was being held in the case of Abdul Qasim Khan versus God Almighty. Remember the case, Abdul Qasim Khan versus God Almighty. What is held? Ownership should be complete, but not just in the form of mortgage. In this case, somebody had property in the form of mortgage and tried to create waqf from the mortgage property, and it was held such waqf is not valid, because he is having the property in the mortgage form, and mortgage can be cleared and the property should be given back to the original owner. So it's not his or her own property. In that case, the subject matter is not of the person who want to do waqf here. So it was held, it is not valid. So ownership of the property is the first and foremost requirement when it comes to the essentials of valid waqf. The second one, in aliens or dedication to God. In aliens means it cannot be transferred to someone at the end of the, like after few years or after some decades or after some generation. It is complete dedication to God. In the case of Muhammad Ismail versus Thakur Sabir Ali, it was Supreme Court held that nobody can claim the waqf property. Once transferred, is transferred forever. It is dedicated to God, and it cannot be revoked. That's very clear in the case of Muhammad Ismail versus Thakur Sabir Ali, where Supreme Court held nobody can reclaim the property which they have given for work purpose. The third one is unconditional. Now in Patakuti versus Avatalakutti case, what they have mentioned is, in case there is no issue, agar bachcha fayda nahi hote, koi bachcha fayda nahi honge, to ye work property hoga. What is that? Nobody knows whether bachcha hoga nahi hoga. So that is contingent. So it was held that on it's an uncertain condition, and with uncertain condition and a work cannot be created. So it is a conditional, so a work cannot be created. That was held in this case, Patakuti versus Avatalakuti case. And then North Local Board versus Ghazan Ali case, what happened here is, Waqif reserves the power of adding or excluding beneficiaries. Now I told there is a private work or there is public work. When Waqif creates work property, he can define who are the beneficiaries. Of course, among the Muslim, he can prioritize, or he can give to certain part of the people or certain members from his family or certain location. He has all the right, and he has right to add or exclude beneficiary as and when he wants to. So that was held in North Local Board versus Ghazan Ali case. Now we have learned three major essentials, that is subject matter, inalienable or dedication to God, and unconditional. The fourth one is irrevocable. Once given to work, cannot be revocable afterwards. So you have given some part of your property or full of your property with the permission of heirs, legal heirs. Once you have given for the purpose of work, you cannot take it back. It is irrevocable. Once given is given, because you have given it to God. It's over, finished. The fifth one, perpetual or permanent. When I say perpetual, when there is no end or no timeline, so that is called perpetual. It is continuous. There is no end. There is no timeline, end timeline for something is called perpetual, or you can easily say permanent. It was held, I am repeating this case, Karnataka Board Works versus Muhammad Nazir Ahmad. It was held only for the benefit of Muslim, and it should be perpetual and permanent. It cannot have some timeline that this property can be used as work property for 50 years or 100 years or 200 years and then it will come back to someone. No, that is not possible. Once given is given forever. The sixth one is, should not be contingent, like in the case of Hussein versus Salah. What this Waqif did is, on death of mine, the property will become Waqf. Court held that is valid, because it's not contingent. He is going to die some or the other day, so that is okay. That is not a contingent situation, because death is confirmed for every human being. So in Hussein versus Salah case, on death is agreed as a non-contingent case, and that is valid. Whereas Punjab Waqf Board versus Shakur Masia, Waqf with contingency, and it was proved it is void. So contingency should not be there. Then can be oral or written. Waqf can be in oral form or written form. This was held in Janjira versus Muhammad Fakrullah case. Waqf nama should be clear on purpose. That is also held in this case. When you are creating Waqf nama, the purpose should be clearly mentioned. That is very important. Now let me repeat all the essentials for the purpose of you guys. The first one is, subject matter or the ownership of property should be very clear. One should have the ownership to transfer his property to work or dedicate the property to work. That's the right term. The second one, inalienable, that he cannot transfer such property to any of his future family members. It is inalienable. Once gone for work purpose is a dedication to God, and it's gone forever. The third one is, you cannot put any conditions for the work property. It is unconditional. It should be unconditional. And fourth one is irrevocable. Irrevocable. Once given is given forever. It cannot be taken back. And the fifth one is perpetual or permanent. Once given, it cannot have some timeline. It should be perpetual, given for unlimited time. And sixth one, should not be contingent. If there is contingent clauses, and then it becomes void. It will not become a valid work. The last one, it can be in the form of oral or written. These seven essentials with case law will give you full marks. So the toughest task for you is, remember the case laws and write in the exam. take screenshot, read 3-4 times or watch the slide 3-4 times in my YouTube video to understand it more clearly. Now, this slide has a lot of objects that one can use Waqf for. I am not reading out. There are a lot of terms also available in this slide. You can take screenshot and read sometime to understand the objects of Waqf. Or I will just read out for the benefit of those members who are listening through earphone. The first one, mosque and provisions for imams to conduct worship. For the purpose of worship, one can transfer the property to Waqf. Celebrating the birth of Ali Murtaza. Repairs of Imam Baras. Maintenance of Kankas. I don't know whether I am reading most of the terms correct or not. You need to, if you know the term, just correct yourself and read it. Then reading the Quran in public places and also at private houses. Maintenance of poor relations and dependents. Payment of money to fakirs. Grant to an Eidgah. Grant to the college and provisions for professors to teach in colleges. Bridges and Karwan Sarais. Then distribution of almost to poor persons and assistance to the poor to enable them to perform pilgrimage to Mecca. Keeping Tazis in the month of Muharram and provisions for camels and duldul for religious processing during Muharram. Celebrating the death anniversary of the settler and of the members of the family. Performance of ceremonies known as Qadam Sharif. The construction of a kobat or free boarding house for pilgrims at Mecca. Performance the annual Fateha of the members of his family. Durghar or shrine of a fir which has long been held in veneration by the public. Now, that's quite a lengthy slide. You can read them when you are free. Now, the important aspect that you need to remember is there is something called Mutawali, which I have touched upon in the first slide. It's a very, very important term that is being used in Waqf concept. Mutawali is nothing but the one who manages the Waqf property. I will explain what are the roles of Mutawali in an independent session because that itself is a concept. I will explain in my next video. Till then, all the best for your exams. Understand more and more Muslim law terms to strengthen your answer quality. And all the very best for your exams. And thanks for watching me. Subscribe my video, share my videos, and like my videos. Thank you so much.